There's something new and exciting happening concerning the homeless. I've had the privilege of just meeting this man in like 40 days tour. Is that what it is?
Yes, sir. We just completed the 40-day, 40-night tour. Like you've done 40 years.
Yes.
We've done our 40 days.
I guess ours is like 48 of it.
48.
But Bruce Carter, tell us about your group.
Well, we're comprised of two main organizations. One's the Value of a Life and the other one's the Right Way Foundation, which came up with I Think Solutions. And so what I found in Dallas is that we're not trying to solve homelessness. Mm-hmm. We would rather just have a program and a service because those that are receiving the dollars, they don't want it to go away. So when I start talking about a solution, it's like I'm the plague. And it's like, I don't understand. I thought you would want to solve this, but that's not the case. So now we're digging deeper saying we have to find people like you and we call you a solutions partner. And we find out and we pour into you and we beat down doors and we make sure that people stay off of your back. And then you can go out and do the work for the people.
Well, that's tremendous because we certainly have seen that in this community here where that, you know, like the rich getting richer, the poor getting poorer. And I think they want a permanent underclass to keep getting federal dollars to pour in. But where are the solutions?
Yeah, they don't have them. So my partner just walked in, but that's what we talk about all the time. Mm-hmm. I cannot believe. Because if you're a rational person, you're saying you don't want a person sleeping on the streets of St. Louis when it's 15 degrees. If you're a believer, I mean, if you're the person that says you pray to God through Christ, this is something that should perk your heart every night and you should find a way to involve yourself. And so those are the messages that we have to take forth. You know, I am disappointed in the city of St. Louis and its political mess that it has. And so the more I see it, and I've told older persons, men and women, this is a shame.
Yes.
You know, your level of corruption and disconnect is greater than Chicago, and that's saying something in a small city. Mm-hmm. And so for those that truly want to make a difference, I want to work with you. Those that don't, I want to get you out of office. And so to me, that's all they care about is the job, the people that support them financially, and to be that person for that moment. And we need to start making those moments shorter and shorter.
Hello, Facebook friends. We're right now across from the St. Louis City Homeless Shelter on this rainy night where it's been raining throughout the evening, and it has been coming down pretty heavy at times in our area. And just want to spotlight one of the shortcomings in the city plans is they have not made a lot of accommodations for the homeless when it's inclement weather like this. So this the city's homeless shelter can hold something like 100 people are staying here. They can actually hold 200 people inside here, but they're only 100 here now. They went to helping the people who occupy the 100 beds in this facility. They used to have a day shelter in here, but they ended that, and a day shelter helped like 200 people a day, but the city ended that one, and so that means that folk basically are out, that folk and the homeless are basically out all day without a place to go. And so that's why when you come to St. Louis downtown, you will see what seems like so many more homeless people out in the streets and on the sidewalks and the bus stops and park benches. Well, because a lot of beds have been taken away with the closing of New Life Evangelistic Center. And also with the elimination of the day shelter here, many people have less places where they can go to try to figure out how do they get off the streets. And so what happens is that they have raised the temperature at which they will help people to freezing. It was 20 degrees at which they will help more. They'll open up more shelters. They'll let additional 50 people inside here, but it's like 41 degrees, even though it's raining out here. And obviously that makes it even more difficult when you're homeless, because one, the items that the people give you, they all get wet. And so you can't very well carry them around, one, because they're wet. You can't use them because they're wet. They're heavier, and you have no place you can put them. You don't have access to a dryer where you can heat, you know, where you can dry them out. And so what happens is that people end up giving them all of this stuff, and on nights like this, they end up having to discard it all. Why? Because of the wet weather. They don't let more people inside the shelter when it is raining like this. I was covering a tornado and there was a fear factor that it could hit in downtown. Fortunately, it did not. But basically, what the homeless people had to do was they all were sheltered in a bus shelter. They were all huddled in a bus shelter trying to stay dry. It was lashing all of them, and so there was no way for them to stay dry. And so it was a complete, you know, it was a huge challenge for the homeless people who are out here in St. Louis. Mayor Crewson announced a couple of weeks ago that they had revamped the program. It seemed like the major thing was raising that temperature where the warming buses come out. There's a warming bus that comes out for a couple of hours when the temperature is freezing or below. One of the problems that they run into, and I mean, and these are just things they're going to have to work on. One, there's no place for them to go during the day. So they are able to get to a shelter overnight when it's freezing or below, but they get kicked out of those shelters during the day. And so they wander around all day in the cold with nowhere to go. And so they have to wait until, you know, 6 o'clock in the evening to come back here, stay overnight, get kicked out in the morning, and they keep doing the same thing over and over again all winter long. And that becomes a plight of the people out here who are homeless. And on times like this and nights like tonight, when it is raining, when it is obviously when the weather is awful out here and people are just trying to find a place to stay dry, that is that's a tough one, because it's not like they let extra people inside here, inside the homeless shelter, when it was raining, when it's raining, to help them get out of the rain, to help them get some shelter. No, they're pretty much on their own trying to find an abandoned building. And it's very difficult for women. There are women and children out here too, and disabled. And so it's certainly very difficult for them, because I've talked to a number of women who've gotten raped and assaulted in these abandoned buildings where they have gone for shelter. And you know, they don't know who else is in there. And so they've gotten attacked, and they were afraid to report it to police because of the fear that they would get arrested for that some of their past arrests for homeless-related activities like vagrancy or something would come back to bite them. And so often those sexual assaults go untold. They go unreported because the women are afraid that they will be the victims, that they will get arrested for some past violations related to being homeless or something like that. And so it really is a horrendous situation. There are more women out here, and it is hardest for women because often they're assaulted, they become victims, they're out here on the street. When the city had its day shelter open, it gave women a place to go. They could come in at least from 6 a.m. in the morning to 6 p.m. In the evening, and they could get off the streets at least for that long-term arrangement, long-term arrangements, give them a chance to figure out how they can get off the streets. And they could come here every day. They could come here to the shelter, and it was available. Women could come in, and along with the disabled and everybody else, and it gave them a break because they are besieged by predators all the time. The women who are out on the street, women and their children, in many cases, the women. And I talked to one woman who had her children that they stayed in a apartments, essentially. That's where they were, and that's where they stay. And so it is really a matter of survival, and it is a huge challenge for these women who are out in this situation. The disabled obviously, and the elderly homeless are becoming the one of the fastest rising group of homeless people. I talked to woman on the bus stop. We helped her to get into a motel, but she was staying in a bus stop in South St. Louis. New Life Evangelistic Center stepped up to help her, and she's still in a motel. But she was staying at a a bus stop in South St. Louis. She was 64 years old.
Tell us your name, sir.
James Wright.
Wow, this is great what you guys do, as I was explaining to Bruce over here, is that we had a facility, and we still got it. We're working, we're fighting to get back in, but it's like homelessness has become, what you call
it? He won't say it. It's become the new N-word.
The new N-word.
You say homeless like you call somebody a nigger.
Yeah, well, that's it. I mean, they get away with it all. They can, right. they can say that, and then with right. that, they group all this other garbage that goes along with it.
Well, it's sad. You know, I know Bruce has shared with you what we've done the past couple of months. And for us to go across the nation and see homelessness at the level that it is now, I mean, we actually, some cities we thought we was in a third world country.
Yeah.
And it amazed me for us to be as wealthy of a country that we are, that we're pushing that on the back burner. So, I'm really, really honored to meet you for your work that you have done. We're going across the country right now seeking out individuals like yourself to partner up with and see if we can eradicate homelessness.
Well, that's such a blessing. I just saw the other day, and I'm having our women staff, about 15, 16, go see it tomorrow, Harriet. And in many respects, you feel like you have to hide the homeless.
Right.
That they're out there, you know, they want them out of sight, out of mind. So we have to open up homes, and people in the neighborhood, they when they see them, they want them out. I mean, it's really sad, but people don't understand. It's easy to see the problems of the past, acknowledge the courage and faith of people of the past, but we have to do the same thing now, don't we?
Oh, we have to. You know, I was in Philadelphia when they were doing the Democratic National Convention, mm-hmm. and they shifted all the homeless people to yeah. an armory. It's like they didn't want the world to see their city and the condition of it. You hear about cities that take individuals, put them on one-way tickets to Hawaii, or one-way tickets. To me, those should be crimes within themselves because of the deception that's taking place for someone that's already in a bad place. And so for me, I tell people this is my calling. So because it's a calling, all the other stuff that goes around during the day, it really, at the end of the day, it's over with because I got to get up and go the next day. And so until we, as a collection of people who are truly embodied in change, make our presence felt, that means we have to continually doing the work, even though it's a struggle, but we have to be able to show the level of success without you. And then wherever there's policies and buildings and things like that, that cannot be controlled. So if you give me $100, now you got to tell me which way to walk and how high to jump. I don't want your $100. Yeah. But if there is real estate and things like that, that we can capture and help you capture, that's not encumbered with a bunch of red tape and a bunch of bureaucracy, then for the greater good, we need to do that. And then once again, we need to have the American people be a part of this solution. If there is 554,000 homeless people that you have counted at your end time count, surely out of 330 plus million, we can solve that.
Yeah.
That's my position. And so we can't let it be about mental health. We can't let it be about drug use. We have to take it from a system that there is chronic and there is circumstantial. Let's get the circumstantial done. And then those that we helped on the circumstantial, let them become part of our, let's go grab somebody else. And let's deal with the mental. Let's deal with the drugs, because there are people that do come off of drugs that do live a great life, yes. and they're able to go back and tell the story that this can happen and here's how I did it. And so we have to get to that point that we have to do it. And I may be the younger of this trio here, but I treat every day like it's my last day to yes. do it. And that allows me to at night go to sleep and wake up refreshed and ready to go again. And we have to make sure that that is the sentiment of those who say they're doers and they are believers and they are of the faith.
Yes.
And we have to call them on the carpet, and we cannot get lost in those who don't share that same belief of the value of a person's life. And once we start to do that, I believe we're going to see a change.
And that's so biblical. People made in the image of God. And recognizing, and you know, you gentlemen obviously have a purpose. I have a purpose. We have to help the homeless discover that they're valuable. God loves them. They got a purpose.
Yes. I think one of the major problems, everybody think that the homeless is drug users and mental health issues. When we went across and we was talking mm-hmm. to these people, what America need to understand, homelessness can touch all of us.
Yes.
under the circumstances, I had one lady that we talked to said that she had been on the streets for 15 years. And I asked her, she said, no, I'm educated. I had a great job, a six-figure job. She said, I lost three people close to me within 2 months. And I never recovered. Then I had some people that we met that was homeless. Mm-hmm. And they had full-time jobs, medical benefits. They didn't make enough to purchase a home where they lived at. So this disbelief that everybody have mental issues and drug abuse is not always the case. And I think when we drive that home to the average American that this possibly too could happen to you, I think that's when we're going to take this more serious and try to get the people the help they need and reattach you to your loved ones. I think that's a big key in turning this around.
Man, I feel like, again, you touched on this. We've got to just be doers of the word, not hearers only. Our faith has to become something action-orientated.
That's it. We have to activate it. But even those Americans who live in, as I like to say, their little brick home with the 3 bedrooms and 2-car garage, and maybe have the Mercedes, but they got notes and payments to keep them up all the time. They're disconnected to the reality, but every last one of us anyway, has someone in our family that is technically homeless because they're living with somebody. They don't have a place that they can call their own. And so we have to dial in on that. But I think that once you show, as James was saying, a rational person, this is real. You see us in the video, you see the people, you hear their cry. How can you help us? Are you willing to donate $1 a day?
Yeah.
If you do this and enough people do it, we don't have to have homelessness in St. Louis.
You're so correct. Tell us more about your 40-day tour. You've been really going after a crime, violence, homelessness.
We started our journey on a 40-day tour across America with 13 cities.
Mm-hmm.
We started in L.A. We went all the way across to Baltimore. And we saw a lot of bad things. A lot of stuff that I think if America just saw what we saw, it would change lives. I personally spent the whole day in LA, which was our first stop, crying. And I had homeless people concerned about me. And that really brought it home for me. You know, we have a lot of bad things happening. We went to Philadelphia and the drugs. We walked 3-4 blocks downtown and it looked like a war zone. We had people with needles hanging out of their arms. When is this a norm? I watch police officers drive up and down the street. I've seen children on their way to school stepping over people that was on drugs, trying to avoid the needles on the ground. This is not a norm. And I think this mentality that as long as it's not in my neighborhood, it's really no big deal to me. People won't say that, but that's the attitudes that we've seen across the country. And I think the Christian part in each one of us is going to be the major turnaround when we pass this message on to all the Christians in this country. I think then we'll be able to make a turn for the better. Because what are we supposed to do?
Yes.
Stepped inside the car because it obviously was a difficulty with the pouring down rain, and we've got a rain cover, but often that can only do so much, and it's raining so hard it just overwhelmed it. So sorry guys, but what about the homeless? I can step in a car. The people who are homeless, they can't just get in a car and get dry or deal with whatever the situation they have. They're just stuck out here in this rain, out here in the elements. The city is not doing more to help them on nights like tonight when it's pouring down rain. Like I said, I have an option. I can go home. I can get in most immediately, just like right now, I can get in a car. And you can get in a car and you can warm up, you can dry off, and all these things that you can do that many other people here in St. Louis, that they cannot do because they don't have those, they don't have the resources, they don't have a home. So they can't do that, and they're stuck out here. Imagine being stuck out here. It's about 41 degrees. The rain's coming down. Now imagine just being stuck in this situation all night long. And your biggest challenge is trying to figure out where are you going to be able to go to try to stay, to try to, one, get warm because it's cold out here. Like I said, it's 41 degrees and then it's raining. So that makes it even worse. But there are no new places opening up for you to go. And that's the plight of the city's homeless.
Tell us a little bit about you.
Right.
All right. Well, again, as I referred to earlier, the purpose. We work with homeless people and we help them discover a purpose. Okay. Then we integrate them into our family. They become part of our lives. In fact, most of the people working in our organization are people that were once homeless.
Okay.
They start resuming leadership positions. And then even when they could actually move into the community on their own, a lot of them discovered such a sense of purpose and meaning, they want to continue on. And they continue to keep working, and they move into leadership, and they become a part of the family. To me, faith is so absolutely essential. It's a holistic program, physical, mental, spiritual, and I think that's often what government forgets, that without the word, without faith being lived out, you know, you can give people a place, you can give them a house, but they can't have a home. And they have to discover how much God loves them and live that out.
So what is the greatest need for you here in St. Louis?
For the government to get out of the way, let us do our job like we were doing 47 plus years ago, to let us be able to open up facilities and shelters and, mm-hmm. and be able to let us carry on the training program so we can get out to different places. They can grow in God. They can become productive citizens. But what happens is politics gets in. They want to control what's released to the media. They want to control the dollars that come from the federal government. They come up with their preconceived notions and look down on people of faith because they think, well, that's archaic. We've got these new methods. We've got a new sociological approach, and it's not working. It's just using lots of monies. And so let the people of God do their work. You know, we're seeing this all over. The old rescue missions, they did a lot of good. And the Salvation Army is when they're sheltering the people. Did so much good. But we see them shut down in the major areas. They don't give them another location to go to. And they come up with different things, what they call solutions, but put people into apartments, but you got to address bigger issues. Gentrification. Right. Sometimes right. be done by gentrification. Destroy affordable mm-hmm. housing. And it takes the government 10 times as much to do what people are doing in the private sector, but make it so difficult is what it is. We have to have government involvement. We have to have government, but let government, you know, be supportive rather than get in there and the politicians try to control it so they look good, like they're solving the problem.
And there you heard it live in St. Louis from Pastor Larry Rice, the true soldier for homelessness.
That's the plight of the city's homeless. They will get some blankets and clothing and stuff from people like Moms on a Mission and Serving Our Streets and people that help the homeless. But what happens on nights like this, all the stuff gets wet and they have to discard it. They have to throw it away, essentially, because there's no way to keep it, no place to keep it. It's heavier. It's heavy. It weighs them down. And they have no place to get it warm, of course. And so they end up having to discard it. Well, that means you have no blanket. So even when you find a place in an abandoned building, or something like that, it's 41, it's going to get lower, but that means you have no blanket or anything like that, or nothing that you can put down and lay on, so you end up laying on the floor in an abandoned building or on the sidewalk, both of which are cold. And that becomes your plight and your situation. It's a tough one. Like I said, there are a lot of groups that there are veterans out here that I've seen that can't get as much help from VA as they need. Some we've been able to help a couple get going, spotlighting their case as we continue, like Ron Fain, Marine Corps veteran. We continue to spotlight his case. There have been some families we've been able to spotlight. But it is a challenge out here. The homeless advocates and the city of St. Louis not doing enough and not doing enough that's innovative. It's not a whole lot of difference from last year as far as what the Carusin administration is doing. The biggest change, like I said, and it's significant, was raising the temperature from 20 degrees to freezing, but took long enough to get the administration to do that. But what they won't do is two things that would make a difference. Letting the New Life Evangelistic Center reopen with 200-300 beds that the homeless could stay in, and starting back up the day shelter here at Biddle House. Those things would make a difference. They could make 500 more beds for the homeless, giving them a place to go, a place to be, and giving them opportunity to get one out of the elements, and maybe some time to be able to think and put together the pieces on figuring out how to get off the streets for good. Because for a lot of them, it's just survival and not having that chance to even get a break, which is one thing, certainly, that they need to be able to just figure out a way out of their situation, because it's a hard situation. It is going to continue to get worse in the months ahead, because we'll talk about cold, and we'll talk about snow, and we'll talk about all the elements that's coming. Now it's rain, and it's cold, but now it's rain, which pretty soon we'll be talking about snow and everything else. And so it is a matter of, I think what would be good also, if the city got city workers with the homeless program, got out, hit the streets to provide some help for the homeless who are out on the streets. I see the private groups out there doing that, and it certainly would be good if the city did that as well. Maybe then they'd have a better idea of the what's happening with the homeless out here. I was here when the bus was out here, the warming bus, and it was on the first night. It was like freezing, and only one or two people were on the warming bus. A lot of people didn't want to take a chance on going to a shelter that the city might send them to, because some of the places were in like North County or something, and they had no way to get back. And so that proved to be an issue for them, not having a bus ticket really to get back to the city. And that certainly proved to be a challenge. So a lot of them didn't want to take the chance. When it got frightfully cold, like it got into the teens, then people had no choice. And many, of course, found themselves stranded in North County and had to figure out how to make their way back into the city. And so a challenging situation here. I think that there is more that can be done to help the homeless, but it takes a bit of innovation on the city's part. But if they don't want to be innovative, they could just take two simple measures. Let New Life Evangelistic Center reopen, and reopen the city-owned, the city homeless shelter, day shelter. Let that reopen.
On this 40-day tour,
yeah.
If we would have only seen the bad stuff,
yeah,
it would have been impossible to complete this tour. So one of the positive things that we got off of this 40-day tour was we got the opportunity to meet people like yourself. And we got out and we talked to the people. When you talk to the people, yes, the people will direct you to the ones that's actually putting in the work. So it enabled us to talk to several nonprofits. And with that positive part for us, it allows us to learn and gain best practices. So we've compiled a lot of information over this 40-day journey. We can identify the bad stuff, but we also can identify the good stuff. So we're proud, and it's a pleasure meeting you as well.
Bless you, gentlemen. Thank you so much.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.